how we've overcome, and we'll understand it better by and by. We are often tossed and driven on this restless sea of time. Somber skies and howling tempests oft succeed the bright sunshine, but in that land of perfect day, when the mist have rolled away, we will understand it better by and by. And oh, by and by, when the morning comes, God are gathered at home, we will tell
the story.
Oh, how we've overcome, and we'll understand it better by and by. Trials dark on every hand, and we cannot understand all the ways that God will lead us to that blessed promised land. But He guides us with His eye, and we'll follow till we die. We will understand it better by. How we've overcome, and we'll understand it better by and by.
And those of you that have your Bibles ready, you may turn with me to the Old Testament book of Ecclesiastes, chapter 5. We want to look at verse number 15. Ecclesiastes, chapter 5, verse number 15. There should be a pew Bible there in front of you if you don't have one, a red Bible. Put your finger there and turn to the back of the Bible to Revelation chapter 14 and verse number 13. Two portions of scripture I want to read for you today. Ecclesiastes 5 and 15 and Revelation 14 and 13. Ecclesiastes 5 and 15 says, as he came forth from of his mother's womb, naked shall he return to go as he came, and shall take nothing of his labor which he may carry away in his hand. Turning over to Revelation chapter 14, verse number 13. And I heard a voice from heaven saying unto me, write, blessed are the dead which die in the Lord from henceforth. Yea, saith the Spirit, that they may rest from their labors, and their works do follow them. Turn around and look at your neighbor and say, you can't take it with you. Turn around and look at somebody else you didn't come here with. Say, you can't take it with you. God bless you today. in a fairy tale published by Hans Christian Andersen in April 1837. The author tells the story of two swindlers who pull a fraud on an exhibitionist emperor who is obsessed with clothing and fashion. The swindlers, posing as weavers or fashion designers, promise the emperor and his court that they will tailor an outfit that can only be seen by the wise. When the emperor is dressed by the weavers, no one around the emperor wants to admit that he is in fact naked. That is, until he marches out in public, donning his birthday suit, and a little boy suddenly shouts, "The emperor has no clothes." Anderson may get the credit for his allegory, but it can actually be traced all the way back to 1052, and perhaps even earlier. This is not a public building for anybody just to walk in and use. The reason this allegory has persisted is simple. It teaches the important lesson that we should never be afraid to criticize something or someone just because the majority seem to accept it. This fable teaches us to always stand for truth and tell it like it is. Are y'all going to help me preach this? Solomon tells it like it is. In our scripture text, he is laying out in plain language the state of a rich worldly sinner. I contrasted his text with text from another writer, John, imprisoned on the Isle of Patmos, who describes this rich man's counterpart, the dead who die in the Lord. It's quite a contrast. One is rich in sin, the other is poor in spirit. One lives in his kingdom, the other will one day enter into his kingdom. One has his reward, the other will one day receive his reward. Solomon and John speak of opposites. They also speak of a sameness we all share. We shall all die. Oh, let me say that again. We shall all die. Every one of us will die. The day is coming when we will all no longer exist here on earth. We will all be gone forever. Christians, know that. this. That's why we are willing to separate ourselves from the world and live for Christ. It is the reason we are willing to give all we are and all we have to Christ and his mission. It's the reason we do not live in sin, but struggle and fight to conquer the sins and temptations of this life. Oh, death is the very reason we refuse to deny Christ. The reason we suffer the persecutions of this world, the ridicule, the abuse, the mockery, the strange looks, the sneers, isolation, cursing, and in some countries, imprisonment and death. We endure it because we want to live with Christ. To some of you, this sermon may sound a bit morbid, but we are all going to die. So allow your mind to stay alert for the next few minutes and ask yourself what may seem like a silly question. What will I take with me when I die? Well, first, let's deal with what we must leave behind. From a materialistic and worldly perspective, the answer is simple: everything. Preacher Solomon presses us with a daunting array of the inadequacies and limitations of wealth. He reminds the rich man that this is what he can look forward to. Naked shall you return. And when you check out, you will take nothing for your labor. It brings to mind the words we've heard over and over again. You can't take it with you. Solomon reminds us that we came into this world with nothing, and that's the way we are going to leave it. All our assets, the spoils of life's war, will be divided among our relatives. All our church clothes will go to Goodwill. All our jewelry will be hocked to pay for our funeral cost. Even the garment we will wear on the day of our funeral will be left behind. So why do we have such an appetite for wealth? Our appetite seems to grow with indulgence. It seems that the more we have, the more we want. Our increase can barely keep up with our demands. And yet, none of it gives us an advantage over death. And if we acquire too much, we find ourselves losing sleep over worries of losing it. Oh my, there's nothing wrong with building generational wealth to pass on to those who survive you. But the truth is that the average person spends or loses his wealth in the last trimester of life, and most often from the health care bills. Wealth, therefore, is not a good place to hang your hat. It's temporary. Preach, Pastor, I believe I will. Even if you're able to avoid all the pitfalls and weather all the calamities of life, everything you own will be left behind. You can't take it with you. Solomon says he shall take nothing of his labor which he can carry away in his hand. The Egyptians foolishly placed gold coins on the eyes of their deceased to pay for the fare for crossing over, only to have those coins retrieved centuries later by grave robbers. There's a wise old proverb that says, shrouds have no pockets. Well, eventually, someone else will live in the houses we call ours. Someone else will have that cushy job you achieved. Someone else will sit in the seat of authority that you coveted and claimed. Someone else will carry a purse or wallet holding the same Washingtons, Lincolns, Benjamins, and Franklins that you once had. Oh, man. A wise man will place little value in what others will one day strip from him. Surely it is a waste to spend all of our precious energy hanging on to something we can't take with us. Oh, man. But material possessions aren't all we can take with us. We also can't take our knowledge, all of our genius, scientific research, linguistic oration, computer skills, architectural talent, medical aptitudes, and brute strength. Will become antiquated and will entirely lose their purpose. Our degrees, our titles, and common sense, and even our street smarts will just disappear. But enough gloom. Now that we've dealt with what we cannot take with us, let's deal with what we must take. We must take ourselves. Solomon says that he who arrives naked will be the same he who leaves, and we will take with us all that embodies us and makes us who we are. The person we became through all of our earthly experiences that now define our character will continue to define us when we die. the man or woman we become will remain fixed within us. All of our transient possessions, relationships, and occupations of our earthly life will be gone. But the person we have become will remain. Whatever death may strip from us, there is no reason to suppose that it touches our consciousness, our personal identity, and our character. And when we pass to the next life, we will be clothed in that character garment, woven from all of our past actions. If we are generous, Jacob, we will take our generous spirit with us. If we are humble, we will take our humble spirit with us. If we are loving, we will take our loving spirit with us. And if we are nothing but a low-down scalawag and sinner, we'll take our contrary spirit with us. This is what we must take. Now, finally, let's consider what we may take. If we belong to Christ, John says their works do follow them. We've always been taught that we can't earn our way into the presence of God. The Apostle Paul repeatedly dealt with this issue. So let's deal with that seeming controversy between Paul and John before I sum up this message. To the Ephesians, Paul wrote, "Not by works, lest any man should boast." To the Galatians, Paul wrote, "A man is not justified by the works of the law, but by the faith of Jesus Christ. For by the works of the law shall no flesh be justified." To Titus, Paul wrote, "Not by works of righteousness which we have done, but according to his mercy, he saved us by the washing of regeneration and renewing of the Holy Ghost, which he has shed on us abundantly through Jesus Christ, our Savior." So, if we are not justified or vindicated by our works, but only by God's offer of salvation through Jesus Christ, then why did John write that their works do follow them? The answer is not as theologically intense as you might think. In fact, it's quite simple. Sister Robin, our works are everlasting, whether or not they are aligned with God's will. In other words, we will reap what we sow. Turn around, look at your neighbor, say, "We will reap what we sow." The psalmist says, if we sow in tears,
tears, the tears of being mocked for our faith in Christ and the work we do for him, we shall reap in joy. The opposite must therefore be true, that if we sow in joy, the joys of living an unsaved worldly life, we shall reap in tears. Our works are not a ticket into the presence of God, but they do define us. Paul says they demonstrate whether or not our hearts and minds work it in us both to will and to do of his good pleasure. In other words, they are the markers or signs of a life fixed on Jesus. And this is what John says will follow us. God knows if you have accepted his son as your savior, because he sees the good works that come from you as a result of your confession of faith in his son. He knows your level of sincerity, your level of honesty, and your level of commitment. Your works follow you. You can't erase them. They define who you really are, and they will follow you into the presence of God as a record of your faithfulness. God knows if you have pleased him. God knows if you have worked for him. God knows if you have honored him. God knows if you have delighted in him. Well, when we give our lives to Jesus Christ, he motivates us to do the work of building the kingdom of God here on earth. And our works do follow us, not as an opportunity to boast, but as a testament of our faith in Jesus Christ. No good deeds will ever allow a non-believer to enter into his heavenly gates. Jesus alone opened our access to heaven. He died for our sins, and he alone can free us from the penalty of sin. Christ alone can make us acceptable to God, being justified by his grace. We are made heirs according to the hope of eternal life. Jesus Christ alone can give us the right to live forever. Hey, hallelujah, I'm gonna live forever. Well, as believers, we commit our lives to follow Christ and serve him here while it is day, because we have a most glorious hope. God gives us the greatest promise imaginable. He declares that we shall live forever. God will reward Lord, our philanthropic generosity, if it was motivated by Christ, God will reward our loving kindness and tender mercies toward others. If it was motivated by our faith in Jesus Christ, well, if you're not sure of where you stand with God, be very sure, be sure that your anchor holds to the solid rock, Jesus. Make sure by the open and honest confession of your faith in Christ. If you do, the evidence of your work for him will follow you till the day you die. It's the only thing you can take with you when you leave this planet. The evidence of your faith in Jesus Christ. You may think you're too young, too old, too poor, too tired to confess your need for Christ and serve him. But I'm here to tell you, you don't want to be, you don't want to stand before God unclothed like the arrogant emperor who thought he was perfectly attired. You've got to be clothed in righteousness, the righteousness of Jesus Christ. It does not matter how young you are. It does not matter how pathetic your poverty. It does not matter how feeble your steps. It does not matter how exhausted your body. It does not matter how heavy your load. There is room at the cross for you and you and you and you. There's room at the cross for you.
Come and be clothed in the only thing that you can take with you when you die, your faith in Jesus Christ. His grace supplies your soul with salvation. His grace fills your heart with joy. His grace keeps your mind in perfect peace. His grace supplies your life with meaning. And you can't take anything else with you. Alas, and did my Savior bleed? And did my Sovereign die? Would he devote that sacred head for such a worm as I? At the cross, when I first saw the light and the burdens of my heart rolled away. It was there by faith I received my sight, and now I am happy all the day. Can you see the cross today? Can you see the one that hung on the cross? He's not there anymore. He rose from the dead just like he said he would. And he's waiting for you to place your faith in him and come to Jesus. Won't you come? Won't you put your faith in Jesus? I am happy all the day at the cross. Saw the light and the burden. Well, you just confess it with your mouth, believe it in your heart, and talk to God. That's what prayer is. It's not the words you say, but it's the meaning, the attitude of your heart. Words like, Lord Jesus, I'm a sinner in need of a Savior. I invite you to live inside of me and allow me to live inside of you from this day forward. It's no longer about me, but it's all about you. Show me how you want me to live. Show me what you want me to do. Get baptized, get in a good Bible preaching church, and work out your soul salvation. It's up to you. You may give us a call at area code 408-532-ROCK. If no one is available to answer the phone, leave your name and number. We'll get back to you. We'll pray together, and we'll help you find a church where you can get baptized and where you can give your life to Jesus alone. Visit us at www.churchontherockbaptist. Send us a message. Let us know about your decision to give your life to Jesus. We'll get back to you, and together we'll help you find a strong church if that is your desire. Or if you're here in the San Francisco Bay Area, the San Jose Silicon Valley, get on Highway 101, exit Yerba Buena Road, and join us here as we worship the Lord Jesus together. It's offering time now, and we've made it so easy for you to be able to give to the ministry of Church on the Rock Baptist through the various financial apps that you have on your phone or your computer. Zelle Pay is our preferred financial app. It is easiest and free, but we also accept Cash App and PayPal. All you have to do when you are entering information on those apps is enter our telephone number, area code 408-532-ROCK, 408-532-7625. If you are on Facebook Live, at the top of your screen, you see the app button. You can press it. It will take you straight to PayPal. We also accept the Givelify app. You can search for Church on the Rock Baptist. You'll see a picture of our sanctuary. Enter the information, and you may give that way. You may also visit our website, churchontherockbaptist.com. Hit the giving button and follow the instructions there. You may also mail your gift to Church on the Rock, Post Office Box 730-341, San Jose, California, 95173. We believe that God will never let you outgive him. So if God moves on your heart to give today, expect the impossible. Expect your miracle, and believe that God will do what no other power can do. Well, until next time, same place, same time, join us for Breakthrough with Church on the Rock. Don't you give up. Don't you give in. Hey, stay on the battlefield like a warrior. Amen. I am on the battlefield for my Lord.